She knew she was dying, so we had to confront the situation. She wanted to die. She felt awful and was in pain. She said her only inheritance was her daughter. She had nothing else to leave me except her little girl. When Annabella's sister Candida died, she left her daughter, 7-month-old Vanessa, with the same disease that killed her, AIDS. According to United Nations figures, worldwide, there are more than 10 million children with HIV and AIDS. And every year, 3 million more become infected. That's about 6 every minute. Vanessa is one of the lucky ones. With an addict for a father, she's being looked after by her aunt and uncle, although they had doubts about taking on such a huge responsibility. When her mother became pregnant, we knew what was going to happen, and I'd always said I wasn't sure if I wanted to take her. It wasn't because of what she had. It was whether I wanted to have a child, which wasn't really mine. The illness didn't matter. I understood if he couldn't accept her, because she's only his niece and goddaughter. But I told him that if he didn't want her, we'd have to split up, because I would take care of her. I had my doubts, because it seemed futile to raise a child that was going to die. Yet, what we get back every day is gratifying. But looking after her isn't easy. And the first few days of parenting were tough. Because of Vanessa's condition, she needs a lot of special care. At first, it was really difficult to get used to her noises, to her breathing, to her cough, and when she was crying for milk or a dummy. I'd get confused and go to the kitchen for milk and come back empty-handed. I'd pace around and forget where I was. Up until now, Vanessa's childhood had been a story of neglect. Her mother was often drunk and would forget to give her milk and medicine. At 7 months old, Vanessa weighed little more than 3 kilograms. By then, it was evident that the HIV virus had already started to destroy her immune system, and she was suffering from full-blown AIDS. With no bodily defenses, a simple cold could become fatal. Eventually, she did become seriously ill, and Annabella and Jose took her to hospital. I went to see her every day. I wasn't working. On one occasion, she caught an infection in her gut, and I didn't think she was going to pull through. Her eyes were black, and she was constantly throwing up. She didn't want any affection, and turned away from me every time I approached her. By then, she was very close to Annabella. One day, we arrived at the hospital, and her little hand was black, and we thought, she'll never leave this place. But Vanessa fought back, and gradually her health began to improve. Soon, she was able to go home. These are vitamins, because she's a little weak. Now Vanessa survives on a special diet, which Annabella prepares every day. Caring for Vanessa has taken over her life, and Annabella combines a part-time job with her routine of looking after the sick child. There's also the cocktail of medicines which Vanessa has to take, like clockwork. A recent report by the United Nations estimates that more than 90% of infants born to HIV-positive mothers acquired the virus during birth or through breastfeeding.
No início tinha, portanto, a médica passou-nos todos. As enfermeiras passaram, escreveram todos.
And while these medicines cost Annabella and José more than £200 a week, they can only hope to delay the onset of AIDS rather than eradicate it.
Quais é que lhe dão?
Os que me dão são o AZT.
Although such a reality can be difficult to accept, often the hardest part for parents is coping with public awareness and understanding of AIDS.
Vai, abre a boca.
Uma das vezes até disseram que por a gente viver com a menina que já estávamos.
People often say that we must also have AIDS because we live with Vanessa. Although there are people who like to see her, they will only touch her clothes. Maybe because they're afraid. Other parents rush to pull their children away if they go near her, even with us. If people know what Vanessa has, they give us strange looks. Personally, I don't care. Sometimes I deliberately tell them I'm her father, just to see their face. They look at us as if we're animals. Globally, the plight of children with HIV and AIDS is severe. Many living in the third world live a pitiful life without treatment or care. Although Vanessa might not live beyond her childhood years, at least she's been cared for. Early morning and breakfast time. Children are getting ready for school and babies are being fed. Typical family scenes. But this family hides a dark secret. Amidst the normality, there lurks a tragedy so emotive that they've chosen to remain anonymous for fear of condemnation from friends and neighbors. I found out I was HIV positive the day my youngest daughter was born. I had a feeling I was. I just knew somehow. I belonged to a high-risk group. It was more likely I was than I was not. Satano and Manuela met when they were teenagers. Satano introduced her to drugs, and for 9 years they lived as addicts, their lives consumed by scoring enough heroin to keep themselves going. I was totally hooked on heroin when I got pregnant. I just couldn't believe it. I kept saying, it can't be true. I didn't even know I had the virus or was infected. I spoke to a nurse at the hospital. I explained that we already had two children and we were addicts and couldn't have another child. She said the state didn't accept responsibility for that kind of situation. The baby would have to be born, even if he was like a monkey or something. That left us shattered, and the pregnancy continued. An AIDS test confirmed that both her and the unborn child were HIV positive. For 2 years after the birth, they ignored the spectre of AIDS, but then Sarah suddenly became ill. Up until two, she had no problems, but then infections started to appear. First it was tonsillitis, then it was a virus or a fungus. The doctors weren't really sure. The normal treatments weren't working and she deteriorated. Then she started to lose her voice, and the doctor confirmed she had thrush in her mouth. At that moment, we had to come clean about her condition, because we knew she was dying. Sarah was transferred to the specialist hospital in Lisbon, where the doctors had some shattering news for the couple. In Lisbon, things got serious. The first doctor I spoke to said that the situation wasn't good. Children that fall ill at a young age have a shorter life expectancy. The earlier they get ill, the earlier the problems start. He told us that she was ill from a very young age and her life expectancy was only 4 years. Now they were forced to take some tough decisions. They'd kept Sarah's illness a secret from everyone, including their other children, to protect them from prejudice. We had to tell the children. It'd be impossible to hide it from a close friend who visited all the time, let alone from them. Anyway, it's not possible to disguise a treatment using 18 different medicines at home. Sarah's health rapidly deteriorated and she needed constant medical attention. She was losing weight and overnight the thrush which had started in her ear had spread to her larynx and her fingertips. With such a bleak outlook for Sarah, and with addicts for parents, it was Sarah's 9-year-old sister, Mafalda, who took on the responsibility of helping to look after the sick sister.
Vitamins.
First I fixed the vitamins. Then I mix water with it. And then I put in the pills. Mafalda can now remember all the pharmaceutical concoctions she gives Sarah off by heart. A fact even more remarkable when she recognizes the potential tragedy that surrounds the family. Today is Father's Day and she made him a doll's house. She said to me, "Mum, put my photo in there and later on when Dad dies, take it out and put his in." I asked her, "Why is Dad going to die?" She said, "Isn't he?" With 3 members of the family on a death sentence and having full-blown AIDS himself, Satano now sees his life as a short-term proposition. I have 3 children to bring up, but I have a fear that no medicine can magically cure. It's the fear of not being able to raise my children. It's not that I won't get to see them as adults, getting married, the process of raising a child. It's that I want to leave them ready to look after themselves, without needing anyone's help, so that they don't have to go to an institution. But institutions are exactly where children with AIDS do end up. For generations, orphans have found themselves in hospitals like this one, which looks after children too ill to continue living in care homes. The children who once came here with leprosy and tuberculosis have been replaced by the victims of AIDS. By 1997, 8 million children had lost a mother or father to AIDS before their 15th birthday. Miguel is one of them. He's only been here a short time, but is already showing signs of being psychologically scarred. Day and night, he throws himself against the bars in frustration. When his father died of an AIDS-induced tuberculosis, his mother neglected to care for him, and he was eventually taken into care. Margarita Fornelos is a psychologist. She used to work for a children's home and has seen many youngsters suffer in the wake of AIDS. This is not the normal behavior of a child who is psychologically well. It's a sign of a child who's emotionally needy. A child that abuses himself that way is obviously a child in great psychological pain. At 3 months old, Rita was diagnosed as having full-blown AIDS and was admitted to hospital. She was only supposed to be staying for a short time until a care place could be found for her, a place which has never materialized. At least here she's found care and support, conditions often missing in families where the parents are drug users. Rita's never known what it's like to live in a regular family and to play in a normal house. To her, a normal life is pure fantasy. What sort of house would she like to live in? A very, very big one. If that was your house, what would you like to have in it? A bedroom and what else? And windows? I'd like to have windows and curtains. And what do you think call that thing? I can't remember what it's called. A lamp. You'd like to have a lamp just for your bedroom? Don't you have lamps here? No. For children like Rita, who cannot control their future in the shadow of AIDS, being able to control something of their environment is vital. The reference to a lamp is because she wants something that belongs to her, just her. It's something she can control herself. Like the curtains. A house has curtains, a hospital usually doesn't. I believe that she's describing what she imagines as being personal, something that could be hers and controlled by her. Children with AIDS have little control over their lives. Living by a thread from day to day induces depression, which in turn leads to a weakened immune system. HIV develops into AIDS more quickly in children than adults, and common diseases like bronchitis and pneumonia are more likely to lead to death. But perhaps the greatest tragedy is the boredom and isolation felt by many children during their sometimes short lives living in hospitals. If they were in a children's home, they'd experience more diversity. As it is, they're spending time with children who, for one reason or another, are all ill. That doesn't help their development or enrich their experiences. They're always faced with a hospital and surrounded by illness. As the numbers of children with AIDS increases, the demand for specialized supervision becomes even more necessary, and that includes allowing the children to have fun. In an adjacent building to the hospital, there's a playground with slides and swings. It's a paradise for youngsters and is often buzzing with the local children, but not with those from the hospital. They're not allowed to join in. I miss going to the sea, like when I used to come fishing with my mum. It was as if she'd been born by the sea. She loved it so much, she used to come here a lot to pick up lapas and caramujos, which she'd sell. When I was born, my mum wasn't working and was able to look after me and give me everything I needed. Christina was brought up by her mother after her parents separated. As a small child, she used to spend hours lying on these rocks. But then, Christina's mother died of AIDS, and without a father around, her childhood disappeared. The bedroom alarm clock no longer wakes her. When the clock strikes 7, she's already started the day's chores, laying out her siblings' clothes and preparing breakfast. By the time Horatio and Andrea have woken up, their breakfast is ready. Although they have daily contact with an AIDS volunteer, it's Christina who keeps the family together. I've got a test on Wednesday. Rather you than me. Why, don't you have one this week? I think I've one tomorrow. It's difficult, it's science. Remarkably, Christina manages to keep the house going and still continue her school studies. Unlike many of her classmates, she doesn't want to skip lessons and knows what career she wants when she does leave school. I want to be a nurse, because I'd like to work with the things they work with, medicines and sick people. Experience Christina gained while caring for her dying mother. She got lots of tummy and headaches. Afterwards, she started having very strong diarrhea. She was then admitted to the Calheta Center, and from there to Funchal Hospital. In 1996, Christina's mother fell ill and was given weeks to live. On the occasions she was able to leave hospital, it was Christina who cared for her. I helped her to take the pills, to nurse her, to feed her. The doctor explained I had to wear gloves. He gave them to me to wear, so that I'd be careful. Today, the children only have photographs to remember their mother by. They are their only link to their troubled backgrounds and the family they'll always miss. Every day, Louis Martin, an AIDS volunteer, visits Horatio, Andrea and Christina. He's the main grown-up in their lives and met them 3 years ago when he was providing support to AIDS sufferers. Besides the emotional attachment that's created by being together daily, there's also the promise that I made to their mother before she died, that I would try to make sure the children wouldn't be separated and to look after them for as long as I could. After their mother's death, the first thing Louis did was to find a new home for them. He found this house, which although small, is somewhere they could make a fresh start. Even so, the 3 years since their mother's death has been difficult for all three children, especially Christina. Although she can cope with most things in life, being teased at school about her mother's illness is not one of them. Outside her tight-knit family, she's open to society's ignorance and prejudice. I get scared at school because it's not nice. One boy calls me names. He calls me AIDS and makes fun of me in the classroom. So one day, I hit him and told him not to call me that anymore. While Horatio and Andrea are able to continue with their childhood fantasies, Christina worries about the future. Without parents and relatives who can afford to support them, as minors, Their future lies in the hands of a magistrate. They asked me if we'd like to go to a place with lots of other children. My sister and I to one place and my brother to another. One for girls, one for boys. I said no. I didn't like it. It was their mother's dying wish that the children stayed together. Louis Martin has asked the court to be their guardian. The guardianship process for this type of case, the administrative process, is slow. The truth is that the children have been orphans for a year, 1 year and 2 months, and there's still no one responsible, legally responsible for them.
Legalmente, digamos assim, por as crianças, e isso é importante que seja feito.
If Christina could go back in time, she would. She misses the freedom of her childhood and her mother, who was smiling the last time they were together in the hospital. What did she say? Many things. Like what? To be careful. So that I wouldn't catch it, to be sensible. She told you that? Yes. How did she say it? I don't want to talk about it. The bright, blessed day, the dark, sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. It was my fault. All the crap I did, transmitted to a little baby that isn't guilty of anything.